is the first part of several explaining how a quantum computer works. And if you really want to understand how it works and what algorithms they are, you should totally follow the full Master Math course by Ronald Evolve on quantum computing, so quantum algorithms. Here we'll just see some basic definitions and how one can represent quantum computers in our current day's computers. So if you have quantum algorithms, how you could verify that they work, and just to get some feeling on what they do. And this is just the very basics. So let's go back to how a normal computer works. So there we have our data stored in bits. So a bit can take the values 0 or 1. And if you have 3 bits, then you can get any tuple of 3 elements. So for instance, you can get 0, 0, 0, or you can get 1, 1, 1. So those are 2 of the possibilities. You can get 0, 1, 1. So in total, there are these 8 different elements you get. Now, if you have 64 bits, then it's a similar list of 64 elements, each of which can take a value of 0 or 1. So here's one example where you can count 64 different entries, and for each of those, I've chosen a 0 or 1. Now, if you take a quantum computer, then first of all, those things are called qubits and no longer bits. And then each qubit stores a number. So in 3 qubits, we can store 2 to the 3 different numbers. So the indices are the numbers from 0 till 2 to the 3 minus 1. And then each of those values stores a number. So n qubits store 2 to the n numbers. And then there's a requirement that not all of them are 0. For instance, here, totally randomly chosen 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 9, 2, 6. Or another example, the numbers can be negative. The numbers can actually be complex. So these only requirements is that they're not all 0. You can have all 0 except for one of the other. That's also a totally valid number. So this is first position, we call the zeros position, so that counting is 0 based. And then this is the fifth position with this. So from 0 till 7. If you have 4 qubits, then you're getting 2 to the 4, so 16 different numbers. And so here's another example of one such number or one such data stored in 4 qubits. If you have 64 qubits, certainly can't write this down here because that is a list of 2 to the 64 numbers with the only requirement that not all of them are 0. For much larger numbers, so if you're thinking of 1,000 qubits, if I wanted to represent this on our current computers, I would need a list of 2 to the power of 1,000 numbers, and then, well, each of them, well, not all of them, are 0. These numbers can be complex. I already gave examples of negative numbers, and if you actually take a quantum algorithms course, you might be a little bit irritated by my numbers here, not because I'm using pi and e, but because you're expecting that those numbers are normalized. I will use integer numbers or fractions, whatever I see fit, and only normalize when we get to measurements or probability. Okay, if you're not taking a quantum algorithms course, you should just be happy with n qubits being a list of 2 to the n numbers, not all 0. N numbers really means anything you can think of. So it could be an integer, could be a negative integer, could be a complex number. You'll often encounter something talking about measurements. So first of all, no, it's not the case that quantum computers can do lots of things in parallel and you get all the data. I mean, it looks like when you're seeing these 2 to the n elements I'm dealing with, I would now do a computation on those n qubits, that I would be doing work of 2 to the n numbers. In some sense, I'm doing it. However, I do not have access to it. The only way I can look at a qubit is by measuring it. For bits, I can look at them, but or a list of qubits, I cannot see. So that's another big difference between qubits and normal bits. If I want to measure n qubits, then I obtain n bits. So if I think of these 4 qubits, so the list of length 16, then I'm not getting I get a number between 0 and 16, but I'm getting the position. So I'm getting the 0th position till the 15th position. And if I do that, it destroys the contents of these qubits. It changes it. So I can measure or I can continue the computation, but I cannot measure and then say, oh, where was I? And if you have a certain state, so here written again as these 2 to the n different numbers, then the measurement will produce Q with this probability. And that's where the scaling came in, comes in, that I just mentioned on the previous slide. So you will measure Q, the position there, with probability which is proportional to the square of the value divided while probability has to be normalized. So note this Q here is the index. You're not going to measure the value. You can never look at the value in there. You can only make, well, you can make your algorithm such that you have a high chance of measuring Q, if you actually want to measure Q, by increasing the value stored in A sub Q. And that is relative to the others. So after the measurement, the state collapses to a pure state where it's just all zeros and then a 1 in position Q and then all zeros again. So let's go through 3 examples of what happens when we measure. So if we have the 3 qubits, so 8 numbers here, and if all of them are 1, that means, well, we measure the number 0, meaning the zeros position, well, it is 1 over the sum of all the squares, that is 8, so we're measuring this as probability 1 over 8. And the same is true for measuring the second position, because also that contains a 1, and the third positions, and so on. If we get a more interesting value in the 3 qubits, so, well, okay, all outcomes are equally likely. If we get a more interesting input, so we're having 3 qubits in this 3141596226 value, then, well, first of all, I have to compute the sum of the squares of all these numbers, and then, well, I'm getting the zeros position, so which contains value 3, with something which is proportional to 3 squared, so 9, divided by the sum of these squares. Now that is 137. And then the next position, so that would be 1, I measure with 1 over 137, the 4 with 16, so 4 squared, and so on. So for instance, the 9 would be the highest here. So that is giving probability 81 over 173, so something almost a half. And so that is much higher. So I have a pretty high chance of measuring 5. That's the one where the 9 is. But with lower probability, I could also measure the other ones. And then finally, an example where I'm guaranteed to get the right answer, or get an answer, is this case. So if I have, again, my 3 qubits, so these 8 numbers there, and it's the first 5 positions all have zeros, then is a 1 in position, well, corresponds to index 5, and then a 0 and a 0. So in that case, I'm guaranteed to measure 5. So this is a very short beginning, just to get you in the right mindset of how we will look at quantum computers. And in the next parts, I will introduce gates. So this is how we can do computations on these qubits, and then also show some simple algorithms.